In 1917, a law was passed in Britain giving women over 30 the right to vote. T.S. Eliot was awarded the first Pulitzer Prize for literature. And Sigmund Freud published his theory of psychoanalysis. It was the year John F. Kennedy was born. And Gertrude Zella, better known as Mata Hari, was executed as a German spy. On the battlefield, 1917 was a year the Allies hoped not to repeat. Only in the Middle East was there good news. The British had captured Jerusalem. But elsewhere, the third year of the war had been disastrous. Revolution had knocked Russia out of the war. The French army had been rocked by a mutiny. The Italians were routed at Caporetto. And the German army was still firmly entrenched on the Western Front. Europe was now running out of men. And both sides were drafting old men and young boys. How much longer could the war go on? The answer would come in 1918.
There is intense cold here, such as has not been known for more than half a century. There are shivering throngs of hungry, careworn people picking their way through snowy streets. We are all gaunt and bony now and have dark shadows around our eyes. Our thoughts are chiefly taken up with wondering what our next meal will be, and dreaming of the good things that once existed.
These were the words not of a common civilian, but a member of the German nobility. Evelyn Blücher, British by birth, was married to a German prince. The outbreak of war had torn her loyalties in two. While devoted to her native England, she had followed her husband back to Berlin.
Strikes are breaking out in different parts, leading to disturbances which have already caused the deaths of a few unfortunate policemen. We are now entirely at the mercy of the military courts of justice. Anyone who strikes is being sent off to the front at once. In the darkest days of serfdom, men could not have been more in a state of slavery than we are in these days of militarism. Naturally, the people begin more than ever to say, "Why should we work? Starve, send our men out to fight. What is it all going to bring us? More work, more poverty, more men crippled, our homes ruined. What is it all for?"
Thank you.
While Germany's people suffered, their ruler, Kaiser Wilhelm II, played soldier at the front. And king in his castle. Once seen as the embodiment of German power, his authority had been stripped by the men around him. Now, he was little more than a figurehead. But even in a symbolic role, Wilhelm was a failure. There was no room for extravagance, his advisor George von Müller confided to his diary, in the midst of war.
Very many people feel the dangers of this situation and are fully aware of the life led by His Majesty. Hunting and house parties, which is in grievous contrast to the gravity of the times. The Kaiser must appear as a true ruler and father of his people. A ruler must rule wisely and with a warm heart.
The Kaiser increasingly is an embarrassment. In fact, I suspect the answer is that in practice he doesn't have much power at all, and he can rattle his saber and make all kinds of irate noises about the forces of democracy. But when it comes to the crunch, it's very rare that the Kaiser really has his way.
Real power in Germany was now in the hands of two generals, Paul von Hindenburg and Erich Ludendorff.
Hindenburg's the front man. He's the sort of face of respectability. Ludendorff is the radical technocrat and the advocate of total war, who's the brains of the partnership. As a result of the great victories that he and Hindenburg achieve on the Eastern Front, they ascend into a position of not only institutional power, but genuine popular power. I mean, they become national heroes, far more important in the public psyche in Germany than the Kaiser.
Ludendorff and Hindenburg were known for bold but risky decisions. When Britain's naval aid forced them to choose between feeding Germany's people or its soldiers, they chose the army. When unable to win the war on the battlefield, they began making plans to unleash Germany's submarines. All ships bound for the Allies would be sunk without warning. Great Britain would be starved out of the war. Victory, they believed, would soon follow.
If they're going to have unrestricted submarine warfare, there's danger that they're going to sink American ships, drown American civilians, and bring the United States into the war. And so the Germans put everything, really, they wager everything on this gamble that they can sink ships and bring Britain to its knees. And the gamble is completely and utterly against all the odds.
Europe's war was a great boom for the United States. The warring nations needed America's raw goods, the weapons it could make, and the money it could loan. But while enjoying record profits, most of America, and especially its president, wanted nothing to do with the fighting.
Deprived of glory, war loses all its charms. The mechanical slaughter of today has not the same fascination as the zest of intimate combat of former days.
Woodrow Wilson's earliest memories were of war. As a young child, during the Civil War, he had seen wounded soldiers cared for in his father's church. Now, as president, he looked upon the Great War as Europe's Civil War.
Wilson was a man of peace, a man of high principle, a rather shrewd and calculating politician. He had the professorial temperament, the professorial manner. He was very cerebral in the way he conducted his life and the way he conducted policy. He frequently used to compare himself unfavorably to his great rival, Theodore Roosevelt, because he said Roosevelt is a person of flesh and blood. The public sees him as a living, breathing, sweating human being, where they see me only as an abstraction.
Above all else, Woodrow Wilson was a passionate champion of democracy.
I believe in the people, in their honesty, and their sagacity.
Wilson was elected president in 1912, but his first years in Washington were not happy ones. The death of his wife, Ellen, left him shattered and depressed. He told one advisor that he no longer wanted to live and hoped aloud that someone would assassinate him. In early 1915, his mood suddenly brightened.
Something has happened to me which I am not yet at liberty to tell others. A great happiness and blessing has come to me in the midst of my loneliness.
Wilson had fallen in love. He had met Edith Bowling Gault at a White House reception. Soon, he was writing love letters.
God has indeed been good to me to bring such a creature as you into my life. Here stands your friend, a longing man in the midst of a world's affairs, a world that knows nothing of the heart he has shown you.
10 months later, they were married. But their honeymoon was cut short by news of a U-boat sinking of a British ship with two Americans aboard. It was not the first time American lives had been lost at sea.
The Germans repeatedly provoked the United States by sinking ships that cost American lives and American cargoes. The Lusitania in May of 1915 is probably the most famous episode of that kind of provocation. But Wilson, nevertheless, down to early 1917, was able to secure the economic right to trade with belligerents without provoking the Germans to the point of open warfare. In early 1917, the Germans essentially called Woodrow Wilson's bluff.
Germany's announcement of unrestricted submarine warfare was quickly followed by word of an unusual German diplomatic message. The Zimmermann telegram, as it was called, was a top secret message to the Mexican government. That Mexico declare war against the United States. Mexico's reward would be Texas, New Mexico, and Arizona.
The Zimmermann telegram was decoded by Room 40 of British Naval Intelligence and planted just at the right moment to make sure that Woodrow Wilson would blow his top, a very rare event, given his temperament. And when he saw the extent to which Germany was prepared to violate the borders of the United States, there was no choice in his mind but to say that there was a moral issue of vital interest to the United States.
Never have I been so uncertain of a decision in my life, Wilson told a close advisor. But on April 2, 1917, Wilson went to Congress and asked for a declaration of war.
It is a fearful thing to lead this great, peaceful people into war, into the most terrible and disastrous of all wars. But the right is more precious than peace, and we shall fight for things which we have always carried nearest to our hearts. The world must be made safe for democracy.
Wilson's pronouncement would become a quintessential American idea. The United States was going to war to establish a new world order based on the principles of democracy. But declaring war was one thing, fighting another. The United States had no sizable army. It would take time to create one. 2 million men volunteered. Another 3 million were drafted. Either way, the sight of so many men in uniform spelled victory to the Allies.
Senator after senator has appealed to me most earnestly to cut the red tape. I am now asking for the scissors. The supreme test of the nation has come. We must all speak, act, and serve together.
Wilson's public urgings were part of a massive government campaign to support the war effort. But privately, he was worried. Some in America, he believed, were going war mad. Books about war were destroyed. States banned the speaking of German. German immigrants were threatened and worse.
Well, among the more regrettable and bloody episodes of this kind of wartime hysteria that took place in the Midwest, when a mob seized a German-American by the name of Robert Prager, stripped him of his clothes, bound him with cloth made from an American flag, and lynched him. In front of a crowd of some 500 or more people, all of whom cheered the effort on. The perpetrators of the lynching were arrested and brought to trial. A jury acquitted them in 20 minutes, saying that what they had done was patriotic murder.
America was going to war to make the world safe for democracy, but its own house was far from in order. 1917 was a year of race riots and lynchings. That summer, the issues of race and war collided in Houston, Texas, when police harassment of African-American soldiers led to a shooting spree by an entire battalion. 17 white civilians were killed. Over 100 men were court-martialed. The largest murder trial in U.S. history. 13 men were hanged without the constitutional right to appeal.
The black soldiers who were stationed in Houston were not used to Jim Crow. They were not used to the petty humiliations of daily life. This is the prehistory of the mutiny. When you put it in the context of riots that took place in which black life was taken with impunity, in St. Louis, for instance, in the spring and summer of 1917, you can see why these soldiers were very sensitive about being attacked themselves.
The U.S. government gave second thoughts to the arming of black men. Most served as laborers. Only after lobbying by black leaders like W.E.B. Du Bois were two combat regiments formed. Fighting for democracy overseas, Du Bois' reasoning went, might one day bring full citizenship at home.
Let us, while the war lasts, forget our special grievances and close ranks. Out of this war will rise an American Negro. The right to vote, and the right to work, and the right to live without insult. These things may not and will not come at once. but they are written in the stars.
Days come and go. Every hour brings its fears, disappointments, and vague hopes. The feeling towards the Kaiser is steadily diminishing in loyalty and respect. The same people who greeted him so warmly a short time ago with Ave Caesar are now distributing leaflets in the back streets of Berlin, proclaiming, "Down with the Kaiser, down with the government." More and more, Ludendorff and his adherents are perceiving the fatal mistakes of the U-boat war and the madness of ever allowing things to go so far that America should enter the war.
By the spring of 1918, it was clear that Germany's civilian population faced shortages that the Allies never had to endure. The U-boat campaign had failed, but there was still time for a massive final attack on the Western Front.
The troops are packed in positions so tight that those in the front have been there for the last 10 days. For weeks past, ammunition has been hauled and hauled, night after night, to be piled in mountains round the guns. All that is to be poured out on the enemy.
Rudolf Binding was one of a million German soldiers secretly amassed along 50 miles near the old battlefield of the Somme. Even for battle-weary veterans, the sight of so many troops raised hopes that victory was finally near.
I hardly know how to write. Tomorrow there will be nothing to keep secret, for then hell breaks loose. It will be a drama, like a Greek tragedy.
Ludendorff believed he could accomplish what no general had done in over 3 years of fighting. He would break through the trenches, end the stalemate, and win the war.
There is an extraordinary moment when a society that has suffered very severe shortages collectively holds its breath. This is March 1918. A month before, 2 months before, massive strikes in Berlin, major unrest, political movements calling for compromise peace, something to justify all the sufferings that had gone on. And right then and there is the moment when virtually the entire nation stopped, suspended judgment, suspended disbelief, and waited for the army to deliver the victory that they promised. That's the 21st of March, 1918.
In the early morning of March 21st, 1918, German artillery began raining shells down on the British Fifth Army. In just 4 hours, over a million shells, many of them filled with poisonous gas, fell on the British lines. Message runner Robert Cude was among those who suffered through the bombardment.
At 4:50 a.m., a barrage awakens us, only to find a thick fog enveloping the whole ground. All phone lines are down, and the only means of communication is by runners. Mist obscures everything. Jerry is all round and behind our lines. It is a most impossible state of affairs.
Specially trained German stormtroopers, armed with machine guns and flamethrowers, swarmed over the British lines. What remained of the British Fifth Army collapsed.
All wounded have to be left. It has been a nightmare, and one that I do not plan. He shells us all day. And in the afternoon, he gives us a touch of his gas. It is extraordinary in its intensity. I was on the ground, writhing in agony. I was quite prepared for the finish.
In 4 days, the German army advanced 14 miles. The greatest gain of territory since the stalemate of 1914. 90,000 Allied soldiers were taken prisoner.
My soul grows sick when I hear or read the particulars of these first victorious days. Of the new long guns that are being used for the first time and that are now bombarding Paris. And the awful effect of the devilish new gases. There are whole batteries of Englishmen being found dead over their guns. I feel a great wave of bitterness and hatred overflowing my heart. Hatred for all those in this and in other countries who were the cause of this hell being let loose on Earth.
The Kaiser declared the battle won and celebrated with champagne.
Spirits were so high that His Majesty declared that if an English delegation came to sue for peace, it must kneel before the German standard. For it was a question here of victory of the monarchy over democracy.
Over the next 4 months, the German army launched 5 major assaults over different parts of the Allied line. The story was always the same. At first, the attack succeeded as the Allies gave ground. But for every Allied trench captured, there was always another one for the Germans to take. Soon, the elite German stormtroopers were a spent force. In desperation, Ludendorff resorted to the old and murderous tactic of mass assault.
The other day, Fritz made 13 attacks upon our little front. As usual, he came in mass. At one place, 7 waves, shoulder to shoulder. But all he got was a devil of a hiding.
The Australian, Cyril Lawrence, had survived the Gallipoli and 2 years of fighting on the Western Front. He was shocked to see the German army wasting itself away.
Our machine guns had the day of their lives. They all agree that it was simply murder. The bodies piled and piled up. Fritz's casualties must be enormous. I think it will be all over shortly. It cannot go on at this rate.
Ludendorff thought that by an act of will, he could break the resistance of the British and the French. Not by an act of power, but by an act of will. And that's what a gambler does. It's not rational. It's supernatural.
Before the battle ended, Ludendorff visited the front. Not to view the offensive, but to identify of his stepson, the second he had lost. The war, he said, has spared me nothing. Now it was the Allies' turn to take up the offensive. The German army was behind its formidable defenses, known as the Hindenburg Line. But the British commander, General Douglas Haig, gave no thought of pausing. He chose to attack.
And they culminate in the breaking of the Hindenburg Line on the 29th of September, which is really an amazing operation. Haig received a telegram from the British government saying, in effect, if you sustain large numbers of casualties attacking the Hindenburg Line, you're done, we'll get you this time. And Haig said, what a lot of no-hopers these guys are, and went ahead and attacked, and broke through in 24 hours. British by now have got the artillery game so well under their belts that they just devastate the Hindenburg Line. It really is an extraordinary example of a well-planned, well-conducted military operation on the Western Front in World War I. You don't have too many of those.
The enemy appears to shoot all day and all night long. Against us, we shall have thousands of tanks, tens of thousands of airmen, hundreds of thousands of hearty young men, behind whom there will be an American army which may number a million. I have seen too much in these last days. Signs and in the end, even if an individual nation does not get its deserts, humanity will. This generation has no future and deserves none.
The German army was now in retreat all along the Western Front. Those not withdrawing were surrendering by the thousands.
It's like a house of cards. The whole of the edifice of German society is based upon the power of the army. And when the army can't deliver victory, what can it deliver? 2 more years of stalemate? 3 more years? Shortages? Disease? Time of the worst influenza epidemic in history? What's the going on?
The Kaiser was told what Admiral von Müller called the bitter truth. Germany was going to lose the war.
The Kaiser admitted that he had not closed an eye all night. He had seen visions of all the English and Russian relatives, and all the ministers and generals of his own reign marching past and mocking him. Only the little Queen of Norway had been friendly to him.
April 28th, 1918. It is the great adventure, and I am in it.
And Harry S. Truman was one of 2 million American doughboys in France. He had long wanted to be a soldier, but bad eyesight had kept him out of a commission to West Point. This time, he memorized the eye chart.
We had a maneuver yesterday, and General Pershing himself was there. I was in command of a battalion of artillery. My part was mostly play-like. We had a good time and walked about 6 miles besides. There were major generals, brigadiers, colonels, majors, and more limousines than a January funeral.
Part soldier, part tourist, Truman was taken with the antiquity of the old world. He saw himself as a modern crusader. We were Galahad, the 34-year-old army captain said, after the Grail.
I am just now ready to go to a real artillery school. I have had a splendid tour of the Atlantic Ocean and France. And now I have a room with four of the most congenial first lieutenants in the regiment at an old chateau with a beautiful garden. The hardships of this war are sure easy to bear so far.
The Americans had continued to train, even as the British and French fought for their lives. When the Allies pressed the American commander, General John Pershing, to feed his troops directly into the British and French armies, Pershing refused. His army would fight as an American army, he told the Allies, or not at all.
Certainly Wilson and Pershing by this time had no reason to admire faith in the tactics of their Western allies who had thrown away the lives of millions of men up to this point. So it's understandable that they were reluctant to fight in the trenches alongside the British and the French under British and French command.
At Cantigny in May of 1918 and below Wood in June, American troops plugged up the hole between the French and British. Harry Truman found the landscape at the front far different from the picturesque scenes that had thrilled him behind the lines.
When the moon rises, you can imagine that the ghosts of the 500,000 Frenchmen who were slaughtered here are holding a sorrowful parade over the ruins.
In the last weeks of the war, just northeast of Paris, 9 U.S. divisions went over the top. The first and only major American battle of the First World War. In just 3 hours, the U.S. Army fired off more artillery shells than in all of the Civil War. But Pershing found the going far harder than he had imagined. What his troops lacked in experience, they paid for in blood.
Episodes abound, sadly, in the record of whole American units being mowed down, literally, and falling in place as if they were corn stalks cut by a single scythe in the field. So the American attack is, from a tactical point of view, quite a frustrating failure for Pershing.
A 100,000 American soldiers were found straggling behind the lines. A desperate Pershing ordered them shot. His officers ignored the command.
The boys called that engagement the Battle of Who Ran, because some of them ran when the first sergeant did. I made corporals and first-class privates out of those who stayed with me and busted the sergeant.
The Battle of Meuse-Argonne lasted 47 days before the Germans began pulling back.
The actual military contribution of the United States to the fighting and the end of the conflict was absolutely minimal. Insofar as the presence of America made a difference in Germany's decision to surrender, it was not because of success on the battlefield at the Meuse-Argonne or anywhere else for that matter. It was because the entrance of America into the war and its demonstrated capacity to move its army across the Atlantic in huge numbers, now faced the Germans with the prospect of a virtually endless, limitless supply of reinforcements that could be brought on the Allied side.
"It isn't as bad as I thought it would be," Harry Truman wrote home. "But it's bad enough." The same could be said for the American Army. There had been 175,000 casualties, including 52,000 soldiers killed. But in comparison to the millions of European losses, America had barely bloodied its nose. At the end, it was not its army that triggered Germany's collapse, but its navy. With the exception of one battle, the German fleet, too expensive to lose, too weak to fight, sat listless at port throughout the entire war.
"The mood of my comrades is grave, very grave indeed. Many of our younger men have had their hats turned by Bolshevik ideas."
Seaman Richard Stumpf began the war as a loyal patriot. But for 4 years, confined in cramped quarters that he called in his diary an iron prison.
"Mass refusals to obey orders have become routine. Our confidence, as well as our faith in the justness of our cause, have suffered a staggering blow. Our military system has accomplished what no book, no newspaper, and no socialist could ever have done. I have learned to hate and to despise authority more than anything else in the world. I would feel proud to be a German if I had been treated as a human being during my 5 years of service rather than as an animal."
Earlier in the war, the captain of this Austrian ship had refused to give the order to abandon. He and his men went down with it. Now, in October of 1918, another senseless naval command was issued. The German fleet was ordered to steam out to sea to fight one final battle for the honor of Germany.
You can imagine what it was like in a boiler room to receive an order to, you know, full steam ahead, go out to the North Sea, when everybody knew that it was only a matter of weeks until peace terms had been agreed. What's the point? Was a question that echoed all over Germany.
Years of injustice exploded. The German Navy mutinied.
"Now the revolution has arrived. This morning I heard the first flutter of its wings. It came like lightning. It descended with one fell and now holds all of us in its grip. Within the past 2 days, an unbelievable change has taken place within me. I have been converted from a monarchist to a devout republican."
The revolt spread from the ships to the docks, and from the docks to the streets of Germany's cities.
It is a pitiful sight to watch the death throes of a great nation. It reminds me of a great ship slowly sinking before one's eyes and being swallowed up by storm-driven waves. I feel intensely for Germany and her brave, long-suffering people who've made such terrific sacrifices and gone through so much woe, only to see their idols shattered and to realize that their sufferings have all been caused by the plundering mistakes and overweening ambition of a class of supermen.
In late October, Ludendorff put on a disguise and fled Germany. A few days later, the Kaiser also chose to run away. As Wilhelm crossed over the border into neutral Holland, he handed his sword to a startled Dutch sentry. It was the last gesture of a posturing warrior.
We are staggered to read the news that commencing at 11 a.m. today, an armistice will be enforced at Jerry's asking. I am up forward at the time, and the lads let off all their ammunition. The artillery too do not mean to be saddled with spare shells, and so right up to the minute of the time fixed for the armistice, they're pumping over shells as fast as they can.
Robert Coode's experience was not unusual. The killing went on until the last minute. Then, at 11 o'clock, on the 11th day of the 11th month of 1918, the guns fell silent. Soldiers, like the Australian Cyril Lawrence, found it hard to adjust to the stillness. What, he wondered, would life be like without war?
This is a marvelous war, you know, when you think it over. Life will be awfully tame afterwards. Really, I do not know what we shall do for excitement. Where shall we see such things as a bombardment at night? With the thousands of gun flashes stabbing the air everywhere. The indescribable din and noise. The that accompanies the sight of a balloon coming down in flames. The excitement of a gas attack when you spend hours in a helmet and the whole atmosphere is deadly. The awful mud and the constant striving against difficulties. Danger. And death. I can never forget how none of us could sleep when we went on leave that time. The quiet disturbed us.
In Allied cities, people took to the streets. And newsreel cameras were there to record the jubilation. This was part of the story, but not all. For most people, the idea of celebrating was like cheering in a cemetery. 9 million people were gone. Millions more were injured in body and spirit. For Princess Blücher, added to the sense of personal loss, was the knowledge that Germany had lost the war. And the suffering would continue.
The few people I have already spoken to were depressed and horrified by the terms of the armistice. Especially that the blockade is not to be raised, which means for so many people a gradual death from exhaustion. As one woman said to me, the idea of continuing to exist and work on a minimum of food was so dreadful that she thought it would be the most sensible thing to go with her child and try to get shot in one of the numerous street fights. Another lady is contemplating turning the gas on herself and her two small children and putting an end to the horrors of living.
After peace comes, there is one thing that we can be sure of, and that is that we shall all be poorer. Poorer physically because we have been weakened by the hardships. We shall be poorer financially for obvious reasons. We shall be poorer mentally and intellectually because so many of our cleverest lie under the sod these days. People pray for peace, and I wonder if they realize what pain it is going to cause so very many. Peace. The boys will come marching home, happy, radiantly happy and victorious. Upon the doorsteps and at the gates, there will be loving hearts and arms to gather them in. But think again. There will be empty doorways and gateways. There will be tears of sorrow, and behind many and many a window will be a mother whose boy is not coming up the street. There will be wives and little children to whom the word daddy can only be a memory.
In the days to come, the world would learn a truth. It is far easier to wage war than make peace.